Welcome to Music and Booze with Mo. I'm Mo Herms, and I've worked in the music industry most of my life, so have met some pretty amazing musicians over the years. I also love a good cocktail, and I've encountered some really interesting bartenders as well. It seems that there's a lot of crossover, so when I can, I like to talk to musicians and bartenders about music and booze. Join us at the bar, won't you? Music and Booze with Mo is brought to you by the Independent FM Los Angeles. You can tune in to Indie at theindependent.fm online, and you can also find us on Facebook. In order to get an idea of who is on when, you can find me, Mo, on the Independent FM Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Pacific time, and Fridays from 1 to 3 as well. We spin all kinds of indie and alternative music, and it's a really good time, so check out the Independent FM. Today, we talk tiki and punk rock with Mr. and Mrs. Bum, Jeff and Annene Berry. Jeff Beachbum Berry has written several great cocktail books, such as Potions of the Caribbean and the Grog Walk, which have brought about the great tiki cocktail resurgence we are experiencing now. Together with his wife Annene, they opened Latitude 29 in New Orleans, which is where we sat down to talk music and booze.
Well, I'm just going to kick this off, Music and Booze, if you two wouldn't mind introducing yourselves, shouting at the mic.
I'm Annene Faye Berry, otherwise known as Mrs. Bum, and we're here at Latitude 29, the restaurant I have with my husband, Beachbum Berry.
Jeff Beachbum Berry.
Yeah.
Worst half of Annene K. Berry. Co-proprietor of Latitude 29.
Yes. And also, I would think that almost anyone, whether they are tiki people or not, would kind of be aware of who you are, because you've done so much, I think, in just the resurgence of cocktails, good cocktails, you know. Someone once said to me that tiki cocktails, it was someone who's a tiki person at heart, and he said years ago, well, you know, people consider tiki files the Trekkies of the cocktail world. Like, it's true, we are such nerds. However, these drinks are so wonderful because of all the thought and care that goes into them. And then there's all those ingredients. So you really brought that back, I think, to a lot of people. So that said, I don't know that we need to go into booze so much. Something else that I've heard a lot about tiki, and you may have heard things similar, is that it's also a place where subcultures go to retire. No? No? Haven't heard
That's
that one?
Great.
And the first time I heard that was when I commented on how many old punk rockers I know in the tiki scene.
Guilty so, as charged.
Right? Yeah. And so, Annene, I remember at some point when I knew that we had a mutual friend, and that mutual friend was very active in sort of the arty rock, you know, music scene of the 80s, and that you guys were friends. And I think we may have another friend in common who's from that sort of scene too, and I was all, oh, she must have been involved in some freaky stuff.
Well, I moved to New York in 1977, and it was like one of the, I guess it, pretty much the second wave of people that came, kind of like where television and Blondie and the Talking Heads had all passed through CBGBs, and we're sort of like on, like,
following that.
But the Ramones were still playing there. That was the first show I ever saw in New York. And I hung out with all the No Wave people, actually, in New York.
I love the No Wave stuff.
For a couple of years there.
And then you wound up in L.A.?
Wound up in L.A. in the 90s. Like,
oh, okay.
In 1990s. So I missed a lot of the... I did have friends, though, who were sort of the parallel coast. Like,
yeah.
K.K. Barrett from the Screamers and...
See?
And sundry others.
Yeah. Adventures ensued, I'm sure.
I see
blend in. So, all right, Jeff. Talk to me about being a punk rocker.
Well, I wasn't really a punk rocker. I was as removed from the contemporary zeitgeist in the 70s as you could get. I mean, I love the Damned, and I love the Ramones, of course, and I love the Dickies and Devo and all that. But, and I went and saw them all when they came into town. But mostly what I listened to back then was Ennio Morricone soundtracks.
Oh, really?
And I listened to Martin Denny and Arthur Wyman, and listened to just a lot of really obscure shit, like ambient music before ambient music was cool. Throbbing Gristle.
Well, you know, Throbbing Gristle, you know, they were huge fans of Exotica, too.
That's
which is so fascinating, but also makes absolute sense. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, well, that was the thing. I mean, I thought that there would never be a time when what I was listening to was cool. I wouldn't tell people what I listened to.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I'd go, yeah, damn, yeah, New Rose, great, yeah, all right. You know? Yeah, Green on Red or whatever the band name was, and all the local people.
Yeah.
But I
you're trying to be cool. I get it.
Yeah. I wouldn't tell people what I listened to.
See, if you'd been in New York, that wouldn't have been a problem, because in New York, everybody listened. We listened to everything. Like, you know, we were really into like doo-wop music and the male singers of the early 60s, mm-hmm. like, I mean, especially people like Gene Pitney, who mm-hmm. was just incredibly weird, and in any time and place, and Lou Christie, the same thing, and I didn't know anybody who didn't have just, like, thousands of old records, including soundtracks, and, you know, that was part of the whole thing. The only thing you weren't supposed to have was, you know, classic, what has become classic rock records.
Like Led Zeppelin records.
I never stopped listening to that either, because to me it was like, this is music I listen to. Some of it, you know, a couple of years later, you're like, I don't really need this Foghat record. We could
maybe
the
Boston's
that out the
not
window.
So, yeah. Well, I interviewed John Reese, who fronted Rocket from the Crypt, which is a 90s, you know, you remember Rocket, right?
San Diego based.
Yeah, I'm from San Diego originally, so we were both born a couple months from each other. My brother used to play in bands around in that scene. And when I was talking with him, I interviewed him for Tiki Magazine a year ago now, because he did the Swami John Reese and the Blind Shake record. The Blind Shake being this sort of noisy guitar trio. They're quite good, and I'm forgetting who they played with. They played with some guy from the 60s who was like experimental and all that. So anyway, we got these guys playing with John Reese, and they're doing this really noisy surf stuff. And when I interviewed him, and he talked about getting into Exotica, because he's like, you know, you could go to the record store, you could flip through and look at these really beautiful looking imports, these really cool covers, and you never heard them, but they cost like $20. Or you could go to a thrift store and you can find a Martin Denny record for a quarter. And I'd take this home and be like, this is blowing my mind.
Yeah, and take a chance. And the covers were so cool that it's like, okay, even if the music sucks, I've got this really cool artwork that I could maybe use for something.
Right, yeah. Totally. So what got you into listening to Exotica and everything? Was it that same thing? You found it for a quarter? Or did you think your dad's record collection was cool?
I think it was because I was such a fucking movie geek. When I was growing up, I would watch like 3-4 movies a day sometimes, and you just run into stuff.
Yeah.
I think I must have run into some movies that were scored by the guy who wrote Quiet Village, whose name escapes me. I just had an article about him in Tiki Magazine this last issue, and I'm going to lose all of my Exotica credibility by now.
It makes you more human, Jeff.
In my defense,
we're both very old and tired right now.
Yeah, we've all been drinking more than usual for the last week.
Jeff Chenault, if you're listening, please don't kill me. There's no open carry law down here.
We all know that this is like a pop quiz. You can't answer them when we demand the answers to those questions.
Yeah.
So I would
I'd watch Japanese monster movies. I'd watch foreign films by Antonioni and Fellini. So that's how I got into Nino Rota.
Oh, I love Nino Rota.
I'd watch spaghetti westerns. That's how I got into Ennio Morricone. Bond movies, John Barry. And that just led me down this path of, okay, what else have they done? And one way or another, I encountered Martin Denny probably through some movie somewhere. And by the early 70s, I was like 13, 14, I was just finding these things and listening. And by the way, finding these things was not easy. I mean, there's no internet back then. There was no Amazon.com.
Oh, no. I had lists with my holy grails on them, right? Yeah. Someone's going to England, and you're like, oh, my God, for this Roxy Music record. You know, whatever it happened to
exactly.
be.
Exactly.
This version of this, because when they released it there, it had an extra song on it, you know?
Exactly. It's totally random. I mean, mm-hmm. you could be going to the Salvation Army or AmVet's thrift store for 3 solid years with your list in your pocket and not finding what you want. Mm-hmm. And also not knowing that these things exist. You were discovering it.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing on the internet to tell you what the catalog was.
Yeah.
Like, if you would find, one would find albums by Martin Denny, you just didn't know existed. Like, okay, here's Quiet Village. Maybe that's the only record.
Right.
Maybe this guy's one hit wonder. Maybe it's the only record he ever recorded. 4 or 5 years down the line, you'd go to a used record store in Vegas, you'd find, oh my God, here's another one. Oh, look, he did one with a synth. And I was like, this is amazing. Oh my, and he's covering like disco songs.
Yeah. So,
and you just didn't know, you didn't have the catalog. That information had not been written down yet.
It was not really available to the public. I think that stuff was cataloged away maybe at the label.
Yeah, maybe Liberty Records had it.
Right? At some point, but they weren't around. Yeah, it's not like that was out for the public.
I walked around New York City. My parents made the comment about his father's record collection. My father and mother's record collection was the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and all of that stuff. Like, I mean, I hated the Doors for years. My dad would listen to the Doors when he was in a particularly foul mood. And,
so your association
was
not good.
I just associated it with grumpy dad. I walked around.
That.
I'd always been. I was raised with pop music. I lived in Atlanta in the late '60s, and it was a really amazing time for radio. There was no top 40. It was local radio. We had our local top 100, and Atlanta was like an explosive pop music scene. A lot of like soul music and R&B, and just a really great place to be listening to music that was just available to everybody. Ted Turner's early Channel 17 on UHF, before he ever had any Turner broadcasting. On the weekends, they would make videos and play like the
top
40 with these crazy homemade
crazy
videos
graphics.
That they just did.
I wonder if any of that is turned up on YouTube.
I have never found it. Yeah. And it just
because
like,
makes me think
it was
of
very
Netflix.
Literal-minded. So if the song was Hitching a Ride,
yeah, it would be somebody hitching a ride.
So I think they let their children.
And that makes me think of like a less sophisticated Night Flight when Night Flight came around. There were actual videos by then.
Right.
But they also.
Well, I mean, you had things like it was slow. You know, you had the Playboy After Dark.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh
had,
yeah. Oh my God. Yeah. I've seen clips of that.
That was one of the first places where you could really. I mean, you did not see musicians back then. You saw the occasional photo of them.
And if you did, it was like David Bowie.
Yeah.
Because he was so arty that, of course, he made a video in the 60s,
but,
right?
I ended up walking around New York, you know, when I first moved there when I was 16, and singing songs to people in record stores because that was the only way that I could find all these 45s that I'd listen to.
I'm going to confess something to you guys then. I worked at Amoeba Records in Hollywood when it first opened.
Oh.
I practically lived there.
I know, right? When I lived in the Bay Area for a long time, so I'd known the Amoeba family. When I was moving to LA, the job I had disappeared because 9/11 had just happened, and it was in a music supervisory role, and they changed their focus, and I didn't have a job. So I talked to the Amoeba folks. I'm like, please, 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 you know me. I will help open that store. So they threw me at the info desk, which is basically where you go, and you're like, does this still exist? We can look things up, see, oh, that's out of print, or this got reissued. But I would often have people come sing to me.
Yeah.
And usually it was all right, but sometimes I'm like, I'm going to have to pull somebody else in on this. And we'd have like two or three people there. We're like, okay, we're not trying to torture you. Can you sing it again?
We're not laughing at you.
No, and we weren't. We genuinely weren't. It'd be like, oh, it's on the tip of my tongue. I don't know, because people still discover things that way. I mean, they come in and sing to us and still do it.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, and, you know, if you've got a nice record store clerk, hopefully they helped you out.
Oh, yeah. I think I had every 45 that I wanted to have by the time I'd been there for a year. They're all about 20 cents.
Really? That's beautiful. That's beautiful. We always, but it's true, we always have our list. And I remember when eBay came, it kind of bummed me out because I could find almost anything on eBay right away. Mm-hmm. And then I was kind of sad because I liked going into the record stores and digging. I liked, oh, I'm traveling to visit friends in Seattle. We got to go to these record stores. I have a list.
There must be
somebody
in a psychiatric university must be working on a dissertation about that sadness, that feeling of sadness that you can get anything you want at any time. Yeah. It's like you don't have to just find it at the Long Beach swap meet.
Right.
Like,
yeah, because I mean you're missing all this like emotional connection to the
thing.
At the same time though,
I think it's building the story to the song. Because if you're looking for that song or that album, you already have some emotional investment.
Right.
But then if you're going that extra mile, and I think you were talking about this in terms of finding lost recipes and weeping when you would see, no, here it is. Oh my God, you know, it's the lost treasure. And just the joy that it brings you. And now you've got it at home. You can play it for your friends. Yeah. You can do whatever. And you're just like, oh, a little piece of my life has just come back to me.
It's also
know?
The human nature is just about complaining about stuff. Like when we had to find things in thrift stores and swap meets and yard sales, we were complaining about how we couldn't find anything. And now we can find anything at the touch of a fingertip. It's like we're complaining that it's so
it's
easy.
It's so easy.
Yeah, that there's no thrill of anticipation anymore.
We're horrible. We're horrible
we're just
people.
Awful people.
Well, it's a good thing we have places to escape like bars. And that is one of the other things that I talk about with the booze and music is bars to me are always, and you have like one of the most beautiful tiki bars ever. So there, it's an escapism, regardless of what it looks like on the inside. This takes it to another level, of course. It's my kind of escapism because I always want to be on the beach. But, you know, I always look at it as you're home away from home, where you go and you don't want to think about work right now, or maybe you've gotten a fight with your significant other and just need to calm down, whatever. And you can put on a record and calm yourself down and come have a lovely drink, calm yourself down, kind of put yourself in a place. So I think I've always seen that connection, too. So for you two as saloon keepers, as I think you like to refer to yourself, why did you guys finally decide to open a bar? You'd been in the cocktail culture world for such a long time.
Because the cocktail culture world didn't pay.
It's true. If you do the bar thing right, you can make money hand over fist.
Well, I can tell you right now.
Being a musician doesn't pay either. So.
No, if there are any aspiring cocktail book writers out there, stop now. Find something else. Go to real estate school.
Yeah, any cocktail book you write becomes a two-year if you do it correctly, becomes like a two-year project that you then use to get yourself actual paying work. So it's sort of like having a portfolio or something like
true,
that.
True, true. There is that. And so it wasn't because of love of the game? You want to like meet community?
Of course. I mean, we didn't go... Yeah, I mean, we didn't.
I know.
Yeah,
I
can't be in this business and not
without.
You have to like the business.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I mean, Jeff had very little restaurant, very very little restaurant experience, mm-hmm. but I had a lot, and he had the name, and I have. I mean, the thing is
you guys balance each other out very well in here.
Thank you. It comes down to I really like, and this is not just true working in restaurants, but I also did a stint in as a television executive in Los Angeles, and I know who to hire, and I know how to hire people.
I worked in radio in the Bay Area, and my station was like a KCRW type thing. Everyone was a volunteer.
Oh wow!
So that became how do I? I already had decent people skills, but it became, okay, you. I need to learn about you so that I can make you work for me for nothing. and be happy that you're doing it.
Right.
You know, that sort of thing. And it was creating a community for sure, a nonprofit radio station, all that. So there are just certain fields where understanding people is very helpful and also can be so rewarding.
Yeah.
You know, make wonderful friends.
I mean, Annene had all of the bar and restaurant experience. She was actually a professional bartender. She was a host. She was like a door person, and all these things.
She's even a co-check girl.
Yeah.
I did. I really, really did almost every.
But, did you ever work in a music venue?
Yeah, I worked at the Pyramid Club in New York.
In New York?
Yeah.
Working in the hospitality side can be so rough. My sister's worked hospitality for like 25 years. But then you worked in a music venue too. I feel like that's a whole nother level.
Yeah. That's why we don't book music acts.
Yeah.
Oh God, that's like a job into itself. You know, you do have to have somebody who just handles
it. It is.
That
yeah, booking is all by its own. It's so beast.
Yeah, so Annene had all that gaffed, and she basically is the prime mover that got this place open and makes it run. I mean, I could not do any of that stuff. But the experience I had was just, I had been a customer for 30 years.
Oh.
I've been going to bars since I was legally old enough to go to bars, since before I was legally old enough. And all that time I knew what I liked, and I developed a strong sense of what I wanted when I walked into a place. So here was a sandbox we could play in where we could create the ultimate place we wanted to be, you know, and with any luck, fingers crossed, other people would feel the same way.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, the facetious answer to your question was we needed money, but but we could have done. I mean, I didn't go to real estate school. We opened a bar instead.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly.
And,
exactly.
You know, I mean, we also had the advantage of, like, we lived in L.A., which is, and we had both traveled extensively, and we both had very good jobs when we were in Los Angeles. No children. Lots of disposable income. We ate out a lot. Like, we went to a lot. I probably had more experience sitting in restaurants than any 10 people that you can find that
at that point.
Yeah, it's just because, again, it's part of your way of life.
Yeah,
there.
It's true. Good. We're in a bar. We're all supposed to be hanging out talking about
this
stuff.
This is Chris Morales.
Hi, Chris Morales. Do you want to tell me who you are?
I'm just a friend.
Just a friend? Oh, that means he's a rock star.
He is a rock star.
Do you want to, just for quick, you can be a cameo. Just tell us what kind of rock star you are and your favorite drink and your favorite band.
I've worked in the blues industry for 15 years. I've studied drum for many years, and
you're one of those guys.
I've been friends with. Actually, great story. One time, Jeff and I were actually going to
speak over here. My microphone died earlier.
Jeff and I were traveling to Martinique one time. We were in an airplane from Puerto Rico. It had been very tumultuous, just kind of getting through the storm in Puerto Rico. We were in the air. The sky was entirely black. The thunder. Lightning bearing at the windows, sparking up the wings. Jeff and I are side by side, trying to contrast stories of Russ Meyer's while the shaker plane is rattling like Indiana Jones style.
Oh.
And just and I'm like, we're gonna die together. And we just met. And as soon as we got to Martinique, the skies opened up and landed safely. We looked at each other like nothing happened. And then we became friends.
Aww. And that's how you became friends.
That's an actual real, literal story,
that's
actually.
Good. That's good.
That's a real, literal story.
I like that you could bond over Russ Meyer, because really, he couldn't.
Good point.
Tourist Town and I have the same birthday.
Russ Meyer is Len in the
sand. I interviewed him twice, actually.
Did you really?
Yeah,
18
when I was
years old.
That's wonderful.
Yeah,
when you were 18, you interviewed
when
him?
When I was in UCLA. I worked for the UCLA paper, and he was coming out with it. I forgot what the movie was. Beneath the Valley of the Ultra Vixens, maybe? I'd have to check the date. But yeah, he called me up and said, do you want me to interview you for the paper? So we went to Nicodelle Restaurant, which at the time was like right off the Paramount Studios lot. And Roger Ebert was with him, who had co-written Yeah,
Valley of Dolls. Yeah.
And it was.
I love that he co-wrote me on Valley of Dolls. Yeah. That makes me so happy. Yeah.
Oh, I know. So he, so Roger was there, and Russ Meyer was like holding forth, and we had a photographer coming from the Bruin to take pictures of us all in the booth. Mm-hmm. The photographer was a pretty straight-laced looking guy. He sat down, and then Russ Meyer was being Russ Meyer. He's like filthy. Just,
yeah.
Just, and Roger Ebert was, all he was doing was giggling in his soda water. Like, yeah. And the guy was like, I've never seen anybody take pictures so fast. He wanted to get out of that restaurant so quickly.
Well, all right. I know you guys have a lot on your schedule and everything, so I'll just ask both of you what I was just asking Chris. How about favorite cocktail and favorite band? Who goes first? Well, it, we all know these things change. This is like asking your desert island list, right?
Yeah, no,
and there are
I
some
mean,
things that stay constant, but some things shift.
I don't have a favorite band. I guess the closest I could get, possibly, where if I had to just listen... One thing
a band is, you never get tired of listening to. How's that? Because we can have several of those.
I will say, you know, I do know what, like, some of my favorite songs are. And it's just an interchangeable Booker T and the MGs song. Can be Green Onions. I've heard Green Onions a billion times. I think it's a perfect track.
But it's such a, yeah. It is the grooviest track. I always think of it as the coolest track. That and Making Time from the Creation, I think, are the coolest songs ever. Like, I always think that.
I don't think people could really mount an effective argument. So there's that. I love Night Fever. That's like
the Bee Gees.
The Bee Gees are one of my favorite bands.
I really like soft spot for Sean Cassidy. So yeah. I'm not ashamed of any of these.
Oh,
things.
I don't have any guilty.
Me neither. That I've said this so many times.
If it's a pleasure,
why do you feel guilty about it?
I don't listen to music ironically either. Either I like it. I mean, if I'm going to listen to a Telly Savalas album, I like Telly Savalas.
Yeah.
No, but it's like one of the things that, you know, that I think really came out when Jeff and I met is that, like, he put me more in touch with the side of the durability of instrumental music.
Yes.
I play a lot of instrumentals.
I had that boyfriend. He was really into movie scores, instrumental stuff, all of this. And my instrumental music before that had maybe been like electronic. You know, maybe it was Kraftwerk without so many words. Some things like that. And I knew it, and I heard it, and I appreciated it.
Yeah.
But not to the level that I did after the fact.
Well, you start realizing at a certain point, it's like when I turned 30 and I got into jazz, too, because it's my ears had grown enough to understand what I was listening to. It's the same thing with instrumentals. Like, if I had to go again, I would pick somebody like Booker T and the MGs if that was the only album I could have ever again, because there's no words on it. And that's the thing you get tired of.
It's true. All right, cocktail.
Oh, I'm actually a straight spirits drinker.
Oh, so you just get something on the rocks,
something
or just straight?
Brown.
Something brown?
Yeah. Rum. I love rum. I love bourbon. I like, those are...
I'm a tequila girl first and foremost. My friends tease me. They're like, for a tequila girl, you sure spend a lot of time in tiki bars. I'm like... That's a whole different thing, dude.
Right. Exactly.
All right.
Different kinds of drinking.
Exactly. All right.
I've had time to think about it.
Yes, you were pointing your finger. I'm like, oh, he thought of something.
Got it. I think if I had a Navy grog in my hand and I was in an insect surfers gig, that would be it.
That would be perfect for you.
That'd do it.
Very nice. Very nice. All right, I'll let you guys get on with your saloon keeping. But thank you so much. And this will be such the punk rock recording since equipment broke. We're on the phone. We're all this stuff. So in a way, it's almost like the zines back in the day. It'll just be the phone recordings. But thank you so much.
All that's missing is someone throwing a bottle at us.
Yes. We can make that happen.
That's okay. Paul Morales. Well, I'm sure he'll be happy to do that.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure, ma'am.
Mahalo to Jeff and Annene Berry for sitting down with me and going through this interview. We had a great time despite the technical difficulties that fell our way. We had microphone meltdown, batteries dying, and then we had unexpected but very welcome guests dropping in as well. You know, that's what happens when you're doing interviews in a bar. And also I wanted to remind you that if you're ever in New Orleans, you must, absolutely must stop by Latitude 29. It's a lovely, lovely oasis in a city that is unlike any other, so it's worth dropping into anyway. And go online and check out Jeff Beachbum Berry's various amazing cocktail books and all the other memorabilia associated with him. Swizzle sticks, mugs, you know, bar fixins, from mixers to actual equipment for your bar. A lot of stuff to choose from there. I highly recommend just about any of his products. So check out Latitude 29 in New Orleans and Jeff Beachbum Berry to see what kind of cool things you can get for your bar. It was a great time, and I really appreciate that they sat down with us and made for a very special afternoon. Thanks, Jeff and Annene. Mahalo, actually. Music and Booze with Mo is brought to you in part by The Blind Rabbit, a speakeasy located in the Anaheim Packing District. The Blind Rabbit has twice been given Best Mixology Awards by the OC Register, as well as several nominations for their innovative cocktail program. For more info and to make reservations, go to theblindrabbit.com. We will be back in a couple of weeks with another episode. But in the meantime, check out my Facebook page, which has more info about the podcast, including links to our guests' establishments and Spotify playlists. That's Mo Herms on Facebook. Thank you so much for listening, lowering your expectations, and joining us at the bar. Till next time, cheers!